Anyway, Greg will be in here in just a second. Can we have roll call, please?
Jim Azure. Ted Bowman. Susan Dolan. Janet Emerson.
Here.
Lisa Emerson, here. Jason Green. Steve Gunther.
Here.
Sandra Hartwell.
Here.
Michael McDonough. Charlotte Belson.
Here.
Mark Moore.
Here.
Mary Jane Mabuskirk. Greg Walters.
Here.
The only one that we're missing that is Ted. Anyway, the ones that didn't contact me. So.
I talked to him yesterday and he said he was going to be.
Yeah, I figured he would be. All right, this is where we open up the floor for public comments. And we do have somebody that would like to make a few comments here, so the rule that we set up is 3 minutes.
Sure.
We've devoted 21 minutes to this portion. We haven't touched that yet, so if you want to go ahead and give us your thoughts, Pat?
Yeah, first of all, I do thank everybody that serves on the Charter Commission, and I also realize this is a very hard job to do, and to get two people to agree on things, much less 13, is next to impossible. I do feel I need to, having read, I've printed out a copy that was on your website, and I really appreciate you guys doing that. I realize this thing probably has probably changed since Monday, since last Wednesday when I printed it. But my concerns on the whole first page is the necessariness of it, as far as it all is good, but I think it's also already freedoms that we already have enjoy through other documents. And I fear it may cause too much litigation for the city, not whether or not anything on this page is legal, but is it defendable constantly. When you say that the city shall not infringe upon any freedoms, whether popular or unpopular, of any inhabitant or visitor, does that mean, I don't know what that means, I guess, does that mean if you have the freedom to smoke marijuana in Colorado, our police will not arrest you and write down because that is a freedom which you own? That's my expression. Or does it mean if you have the freedom to shoot off a bottle rocket, which is illegal in the city of Raytown, but legal in the state of Missouri, does that mean that law goes away? Or if you have the freedom to open up a tattoo parlor, even though the city has ordinances on how many of those can be, are those the freedoms that we're talking about here? And I think that needs to be spelled out much more, because this could get down to tall grass and weeds and health code and all kinds of things. So I really, yes, I appreciate, I can see the work that went into that, but I don't know if this is the article for that. And to move on, I would like to also talk about some of these things which I have to say about the charter is...
You don't have to rush, Pat.
You're not going to hold me to the three. a lot of the things that are interesting to read in here is things that I really didn't even know, even as an alderman, that we had the power of. And I realized after looking into where some of this stuff come from, it's just things that were little known, like the three aldermen calling the meetings and things like that, that really hasn't come up over the years, but I do believe that's the way it is right now.
We have tried to stay,
yes,
in line with all of the written ordinances.
I noticed that a lot of times when you're getting into, sure, somebody not fulfill their term of office, you would call a special election at the very next April, I believe, in order to do it. That could become expensive rather than just going to the next April date where we already had an election. It's pretty close to what you have, but it still would be a thought that I think maybe you should consider.
We have.
The biggest one, I think, is the fact that you would have the city of Raytown tell someone where they have to live. And I don't see that. If somebody does a great job for you, or somebody is great in an interview, I don't see why the city should be telling, or any government should tell somebody where they have to live. And if the best city administrator, public works administrator, where we have, lives two houses outside of town, I don't see that as a crux to their job. I do believe, however, elected officials obviously should live in the city, since we are the city that we're governing. But I believe we should hire the best people for our city. And it's hard, very hard to do that, as I'm sure Dalton can tell you. I believe all elected officials should live in the city, and I notice we've made a difference between judge and police chief on that.
State law.
That the judge cannot, doesn't have to live in the city that they are the judge of? Well.
I don't know that.
I don't know. You, if, anybody wants.
Right, I mean, it's.
It seems odd that, why would a judge not have to live here?
Well, because a judge, our judge is a part-time judge, and they can actually serve as a part-time judge in other municipalities.
And they do?
Yes.
And so that's.
Well, then, if.
And again, we're just following what our.
Sure.
Current setup is.
I think he should consider then whether or not the police chief should be in appointed position. If the, I see on this case, you have a residency requirement of, I think it's 1 year now, before they become able to run, and they have to have the qualifications of being in the police department, or I guess whatever legal things those are. However, right now, I think we have 3 officers or 4 officers that actually live in the city on our police force. 2 of them are on this board, so it really is limiting your focus on who could ever become the chief of police if you have that there. To think that somebody would move to the city and live a whole year just for the opportunity to run for an office seems not the best interest of the people. I would suggest, because I do like the police chief that we have, and I do like now is a good time to say that we get an elected police chief works. But I want to remind you that it wasn't that long ago, I've heard stories about our police chiefs in this town being racist. This city still suffers from that.
That is absolutely true.
And this city, that was elected police chiefs that made it so African Americans did not even feel welcome to drive through this town. And you are keeping that as a possibility for the future. So I'm just suggesting that since I like to find out, have it take effect in 2020. Put it down the road, but don't burden future boards, future citizens, by something that could be taken care of now. And if that, as just an appeasement, that's why I'm saying that 2020, that would take our current one to retirement age, or whatever, you would have it down. And if people don't like it, then they can come back through your system here and change it back, but change it that way. Please consider that. And you've heard my reasons why. I have no concerns with the one we have now, but I have grave concerns if you took an average of the last 5. What would you think of all of that? Appreciate what you did with the parks. Believe me, I appreciate what you did on a lot of things in here. Don't get me wrong. I mean, there's a lot of things in here, but Parks and Rec. I believe some of this is schematics about who hires who, but I do think that it's much closer in there. I don't think the Parks Board needs to hire all the staff over there. I'm sure the Parks Director would probably give an okay to the Parks Board to hire the staff, but you know, I don't know if that's kind of written into the way you wrote that or not, but I like it. When it comes to referendum and recall, my thing on recall, and perhaps I missed it in here because I first glanced at it, was when it comes to an alderman, he said you need to have, what the percentage is down to now, it seems to be like a thermometer, but whatever that percentage is, shouldn't it be of the ward instead of the city? Because you could get elected alderman with 200 people, but if you need 8% of the registered voters of the city, you could take 1,000 votes to get away. So that is something where I feel maybe some clarification in that.
It's our one mistake. We'll correct that.
Okay. You're one.
I'm glad. One?
It's part of the name.
It's the only one I can
Ted, you go ahead. Here. So, for those things, you know, it just kind of makes me wonder about that. As I got back into, and I think I'm going a little faster here. When it comes to granting franchises, I do not understand, and I could not find out, at least, what no exclusion of franchises shall ever be granted. What's an exclusion franchise?
Exclusive. That's our second mistake.
Okay. So exclusive franchises mean you don't allow non-competing franchises. Is that what I would mean? Probably.
Well, it means, for instance, you couldn't come in and say, like, we're only going to have one cable provider.
Okay. That I get.
For one track
it's
company.
The exclusive right. That got me, so I have to admit.
That was a mistake.
Okay, all right.
In trouble.
The exclusion.
Well, that's why we all read this, I guess.
I'll have to double check.
Other than that, those things, which I, which, not that that wasn't a lot, I do appreciate again, you know, the efforts and the works here. Please look at the ability of a city to control where everyone lives. Please look at the perhaps down the road idea of appointed police chief, even if it was in 2020. Please look down the road as far as, you know, where anybody has to live. And the, as I said, on this front page, please look through this and decide whether or not this is worth maybe the litigation it would take possibly have against the city. So, thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Pat, thank you. You are the only one.
Yeah.
Other than our members that are doing double duty.
Well, I think it's good you came.
Yes, I appreciate it.
Well, trust me, we have been over and over a lot of those things.
Oh, I don't doubt it. I've kind of, this has been really good at sending out.
But I appreciate you coming and talking. That's something that we haven't got a lot of.
But.
You've changed the word on.
Oh, you're good. All right.
Don't look at me.
All right. Well, you guys enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thanks, Pat.
Thank you, man.
Thanks, Pat.
Just gonna hit and run, huh, Pat? Just gonna hit and run?
I have other things to talk about tonight.
Who gave you a cheeseburger?
No.
Well, you might wanna hear what Michael has to say. Go ahead, Michael.
You know what? For Michael, I'd bring my chair in here, cause I can take a look.
I want a selfie.
Actually, to some degree, I'm going to reiterate what Pat has said, at least in two areas. One, when I was in business, I found that a good employee was worth two or three mediocre employees. So when it comes to city employees, with the exception of first responders, I don't see any rational reason why we should restrict the pool of possibilities we have to people that are willing and able to relocate to Raytown. And a lot of times, it's not even a willing, it's a able, meaning their kids are in a different district, they want to graduate from that high school, the wife works 60 miles the other direction, they can't get out of their house because of the housing market. There's a ton of reasons why it's not easy anymore with a two working parent families to relocate. And if that moves us from, say, 20 candidates down to 6 candidates that we can choose from, there's a good chance the best candidate didn't get the job. The second item I agree with Pat is that the restrictions on who can be a police chief really make that into a small pool and could lead to a very isolated group being in control of our police department forever because no one else could qualify to run. I like the idea of an appointed chief. I worry though that it may make it harder to pass the charter, okay? But I don't know, I don't have the solution. I just do see that the way it's written now, there's only two or three people that could possibly run for police chief. And that's a scary proposition. That's all.
All right, thank you. All right, we have our new charter attorney. Welcome, Alan.
Thank you.
You've heard some of the concerns of our citizens, which was a great timing, by the way. And I hope you've had some opportunity to look at our drafted document. And at the point that we're currently at,
I think most of us would agree that what remains are the things that we obviously need help with. And so we are very interested in hearing what you have to say about what we've got drafted so far. I'm sure there's some things that are small and some things that are big. I don't know how you might want to handle it or how the commission might want to handle it. If there's smaller items that you want to address that we can take care of tonight, I'd like to get those taken care of. And the bigger items, which might take more time to address as we get things.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to work with everyone here. And what I thought I would do tonight, and you can throw up the stop sign, I thought I would talk a little bit more about almost philosophical, but they're philosophical based on what happens when whatever's the finished product gets to court. And the first thing I wanted to talk a little bit about, because it got lots of publicity at the time, but it's been a while. The Hancock Amendment bears a person's name, and that person drafted and worked with a group to draft it. When it got to court, he wanted to be in court to say, Judge, this is what that clause means. And the court politely said, there's the door, you can go out there. We don't care what you think, because we're going to apply the rules of statutory construction. So one of the things as we go through this and looking at word choices, it's not just what the people in this room, including me, think it means. It's to always keep in mind these words will be judged according to rules of construction that go back hundreds of years. And even though we could all agree in this room, this is what we intended, it doesn't keep a court from saying, well, nice try, but here's a line of cases that says it means something else. So that's just a sort of, as we go through things, remember that. Also on my list was to do a little timeline checking, just so everybody knows, you know, there's an absolute deadline on charter commissions, and when you hit it, either you're done and it goes forward on the ballot, or you didn't finish in time and you expire, so to speak. That date appears to be January the 20th. That's a Tuesday. Now that day is a little bit, I won't say it's in flux, but there might be some things you can talk about. But I think if you set that as the target, because it's a Tuesday and you normally meet on Monday, that would say that on the 19th, if you have any last minute, fix a comma, change a period, you've got that date. And then this body certifies, yes, here's the charter, to the city clerk. The city clerk then has to put it with all the other ballot issues, and the 20th is magic because that's when the filing period in Raytown ends. And so she then puts all of that stuff into the ballot form and sends it to the Jackson County Election Commission. I talked to the city clerk, I talked to the Jackson County Election Commission, and I talked to the attorney for the Jackson County Election Commission just to make sure they didn't have any quirks floating out there. Absolute rule from Jackson County Election folks, they will not take a direct report. In other words, you all cannot put it on the ballot. It has to come from the city clerk, and it will be part of the city ballot that gets certified. So the 20th at 5 o'clock is the drop dead time to have it on her desk. One of the other things, and we can circle back and don't have to do it tonight, apparently some prior charter commissions used what she termed to pull out questions. I don't know if you are familiar with that rule, but it's the idea there's a vote on the charter, but there's some votes on individual pieces. Don't know if you're thinking about that. That adds another level of complexity to how you structure the ballot so that you don't end up with a incompatible result. It also sometimes leads to confusion, but we can talk about that later. One of the other things, and then I will start giving you some general views on the charter, and you can give me instructions on how you think is most efficient to address some things. First, I'm aware that there are politics in Raytown, but I don't play in them, so I'm not going to try to learn all of that piece. It would take me way too long, and I have always given advice based on what's my best judgment, no matter whether my client liked my advice or didn't like my advice, which means I really don't care about the politics one way or the other anyway. The other thing to remember, in spite of that, if I suggest a word or a change, while I'm doing that from what I perceive as a neutral legal thing, it does not have a neutral result on people who are tugging on which word should be in. And so every choice you make does have favoritism, so to speak. Just know that I'm not doing it because A asked for it or B was against it. I'm just doing it because that's my best professional judgment. And then the last thing sort of on that line is, as you're looking at your choices, remember it's all about, can I get it passed? Second, as I read through it, and I've been through the whole thing probably at least three times, just once just reading it and then two times going over looking for various things. The more it's a constitution-like document, A, the shorter it is, and the more practical it is to operate under. If you put too many details in that go to daily operations, you're increasing the likelihood of both resistance to passage and also difficulty in administration. The other thing I thought about, and I just called it Allen's axiom, negatives accumulate and positives erode. So if you write a provision that a group has a negative impression on, they will never turn loose of that. And if they find another thing they don't like, it just sort of builds on it. And so the negatives keep going up. On the other hand, you write something that they really like, and so they're feeling good, but then the next thing they're kind of so-so about, you actually start to lose the positive things because it's always a balance. And so that's part of what you need to look at as you're making choices. You're the ones that have to know what the voters will ultimately do. And the other thing to remember is, in when you're applying that negative and positive, just like politicians have both a negative score and a positive score, a provision can have a negative score and a positive score. In some groups, high negative, other groups, high positive, but your job is to get to that magic 51 or 50.0001. Okay, within the document, one of them already came up, the exclusion versus exclusive. I already looked at that. It should have been exclusive. That's what was intended. That's what's in a number of the other charters, and that's sometimes it's word check, you know, who knows. Yeah, but there's a number of things like that that to me, I could put all those together fairly quickly as I'm going through it and present that at one time. I didn't want to do that unless you say that's the way you want to operate, because otherwise you open up a whole lot of things. Another example, numbers, and I checked multiple sources on this. Once upon a time, the rule was you wrote out all numbers and then you put in parentheses what the number was. The current rule is you don't ever do that. And the other thing is, two different rules. One says 10 and under, you always write out. Another one says 20, because every number from 0 to 20 is a unique word. You haven't got to the hyphenated part. But every source I checked, and several more legal writing ones, are back down to one number using that rule. Again, I don't think that's worthy of a whole bunch of people going through, because that's something that can be flipped pretty quick. Also, it appears, and it was different in different part of the document, there's intent to be gender neutral, but it's gender neutral in lots of places by using a plural pronoun with a singular subject, which violates a different rule. And I have had multiple gender neutral training things. There's one of the things that can be done in those cases, a lot of times it may add a word or two, but you can get rid of all pronouns and then you don't have a problem. So those are things that don't change any meanings, any intent, but just sort of clean up the language, because it's always dangerous to leave plurals where you mean singular, because that's significant when you hit a court.
Yeah.
can ask questions?
Sure.
Okay. Going back to the numbers issue, yeah, I was doing that just because of contracts I've written in the past and things like that. And so it seems to me it's just easier to find it if it's a number and then a parentheses, it's just easier to locate it no matter the number, you know, how small. But what is your suggestion on how to do that?
My practice in things like this, and this is, I just want you to know, this disagrees with a lot of the standards that are published, is I tend to write out all numbers and put in parentheses the numerals.
So backwards from how I did it before?
Yeah, and it also depends, in this particular case, some of the numbers may be subject to elimination anyway, and by just because they're redundant and other pieces. It really, none of that's critical to the charter, and I guess the thing that you can pick the standard as far as I'm concerned, we just need to be consistent, because that's the other, there's also inconsistencies about the book. Whichever way we're going to do it, we should do it all the way through. I really think if it's smaller, like if you're saying 5 years, it should be the word five. I mean, that part of the rule. And see, once you do that and then put it in parentheses, if you apply the second half of the rule, now you're inconsistent in your documents. And your most common numbers in this document are less than 10. They're fives and sixes and nines and those types of things. So if I was going to do it, I would write out the word and then I'd put in parentheses, because it is much easier to find them if that's there. And I think on a document like this that's not going to be edited and changed over and over again, we can make sure in the final proofing that we've got all the numbers, because the other things I got some of the commentators excited about was if there's a difference, if you wrote 11 and typed 10, which one wins?
I hope we can do a better proofreading.
Well, there aren't that many in this one, and so I think you can do it. And the other thing that they use for the basis of the rule is the fact that nowadays in documents that have lots of numbers, a high percentage of those are tied to a spreadsheet someplace. And while you can keep that link and it'll bring in the number, it will not write it out. And so that's part of what pushed the old rule out. But I think charters are kind of an exception. So unless somebody cares, my recommendation would be to write out all the numbers and then after them put in parentheses. So.
As the gender neutral thing, yeah, doing that would make my grandmother's ears bleed, because 100 years ago that was just not ever done. People are getting to the point where it's normal now, but I did not know. So if you have suggestions, could you offer them to them?
Yeah. Yeah. I can do all of that. I didn't want to bring a red line in tonight and say, look what I've done to your charter. I wanted to get a sense of where you were before we went down there. But many of them, you can actually just strike out the personal pronoun and that's it. That's all you have to do. And sometimes you just have to insert the word, the title, something like that, and it's fixed. So again, I was writing documents during the big push when everything had to be gender neutral, and some of the suggestions then would take a 10-word sentence and turn it into a 50-word sentence, and you're thinking there's got to be a better way, and eventually we all figured out a better way. So we can take care of that. Another, and this is a suggestion, there's many references in the document to a majority of the aldermen. I can't tell you how many questions, few cases over the years came up because they wanted to argue what a majority was if you had a vacancy. So I write a majority of the board, and I have a 10-member board, so a majority is six. But what happens if I have two vacancies? Is the majority now five?
No.
Or even one? Well, people litigate that.
They lose.
No, they don't always lose. And the other thing is,
the minority wins?
No, you've already lost if you're in court, because you're already out thousands of dollars just to be there. It is much easier to simply write in your definition of majority of aldermen means six.
Okay.
Period. So you just, it's no longer an issue in your charter. And I do the same thing with two-thirds and three-fourths.
Put in the real number.
You just put in it's an absolute number. And then it's done. And it can go in the definition sections, and it's just one of those things that keeps the lawsuit. At most, if somebody's crazy enough to file it, you simply walk in with the motion to dismiss and say, you know, it says right here it's six, so there's nothing else to argue about. So I would make that change.
But it's not really changing our wording, it's just adding the definition, correct?
The way to do with majority, I think, is just put majority in the definitional section so that most of your words don't ever get changed, and do the same thing with two-thirds and three-fourths, just add them into the definitions. And so it's a very, very few extra words, and you're cleared up. One of the other things I noted, and if I'm understanding right where you are, is still somewhat up in the air as to what you want to do. Word choice, prohibitions, restrictions, similar context to privilege and right, where there's, you know, both words are still in the document. When I looked at those sections, one solution is I can craft, I think, what you're trying to write without using any of those four words. Because if you look at them, and this is back to looking at sentence structure, they don't really add anything to what you're trying to do. You're saying somebody has the ability to do X. So you just give them the ability. You just say, one of my remember is an alderman who wanted to have a roll call vote could say, I want to have a roll call vote, and they got a roll call vote. Okay? I don't care whether you want to call it a right, a power, a privilege. I just want to say he can do it. And so you've preserved what I think you're trying to do, and you avoid the whole thing of putting a label on it that doesn't advance your cause. And again, back to the negative and positive, a lot of those words, that group of four words, have both a negative and a positive depending on who's reading them. Whereas if you just say, hey, an alderman who wants to have a roll call vote just needs to say he has a roll call, wants a roll call vote, and there will be a roll call vote. And there's not much to argue about, and it's just a procedural thing that's there. And so I think doing that avoids some potential discussions.
That's not in our charter. Or are you just using it as an example?
No, it's in there.
It is?
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember that part. I thought it was under Robert's rules.
Well, Robert's rules has some other rules, but this will trump those pieces. So those are the types of things that I would just come back, because I think that's just cleanup. That's not... And if at any time I give you something, you say, well, what's that crazy person doing? He's changing this. Let me know, because they're all intended to be impact neutral. Just a matter of cleaning up the words. There's also a few places. I was looking at the initiative, referendum, and recall. Always concerned if you produce, you know, a long document, the longer it is, the more places there are for somebody to get excited. There are some redundancies on... the election part. The election will be the first available date. The election will be, that's in there like five times. You can put it in one place and you're done. And the nice thing is nothing changed, but you just shrank your charter by four sentences. And that's important when you finally get to the final version. So there's some things like that. And what I would do is I would take whatever draft you give me, and if you give me a new one after tonight, that's fine, because I live in the electronic world, I can figure it out pretty quick. But then I would redline against that and say, here are the, and the first red line by itself would be only those changes that I think are words of construction, gender neutral, that pack. Because there's another group, and depending on how you want to proceed, that are choices that you're entitled to make as a group. Do you want this in or not want this in? I can give you my perspective if you want it. An example of that would be in the, I think it was referred to as page one. There are things there that you could say and you could put in the charter. But when I come back and I apply the will it pass, will it get people into a negative frame of mind, and have you defined everything, then it's like, well, yes, that's a great statement, but do I need it to pass the charter? And that's why you see in most, I won't say most because I didn't go back and count them up. Many of the charters, it's just, hey, we hereby take the power of the charter as given by the Constitution, as short as they can write it. But when you look at some of the things that you're placing limitations on, you're also placing limitations, and one, and it's in yellow, and I'm not always sure what the yellow parts mean on the versions I was giving, but it had eminent domain on the prohibition list. Well, if you actually wrote that, you just reduced the power of the city below what it has today. And so I don't know if that's what you really want to do.
Just to clarify the yellow, those are things we're discussing.
That's what I thought, but again, so I'll pick on one that's still under discussion. So if you did that one, the city today has the power to use eminent domain in certain ways. Again, it's a political football at times as to what they can use it for and how they exercise it, but the state has pretty well occupied that and said, here are the rules of the game if you're going to use eminent domain. Here's what you can use it for, here's the process you go through, and here's the amount of money that you have to pay. So the state's placed restrictions on it. Cities can place more restrictions on themselves, which is what this charter does. The charter both grants the city more powers than it has, but it can also take away powers or choose not to take all the powers that the state's giving. But then you have to amend the charter to ever get back to having those powers. So there's some things like that I think you need to look at. And I gather partly from comments tonight, while you may win litigation, while there may not be any successful litigation on a given topic, the fact that you're in litigation, just almost the minimum for a lawsuit involving the city, other than where you truly have the walk into court, file the motion to dismiss because it's so obvious that it's a flake, it's probably $10,000. And because you win the first one doesn't preclude the next person from filing. It may shorten the life of the second suit, but it doesn't keep that from happening. So
I'm not sure if I follow it. Litigation in regards to what?
Well, if you put something in that talks about rights above and beyond the city level, okay, when you start to get into things on a state, federal, or international, all of which are mostly in yellow, so you haven't necessarily done them. All of those things give grounds to groups of people who follow those things. And so they say, aha, this must have either given us something or taken away something. And so they then want to come and make your city the target of their efforts.
And so
from a get it passed, you have to think about that. The other thing, and this is the really tough ones, I've handled the move the elected marshal to the appointed chief of police issues. I don't know that I've ever handled one that was just smooth. I mean, there were always strong feelings on both sides. Very good reasons on both sides, but just truly differences of opinion. That's another one of those when you add up the negatives and the positives, you have to decide, you know, right now you just said, hey, we're just going to leave it. And I told you in the interview, that's very much like what we did with the firefighters and Jeff. There were clearly multiple camps, very strong emotions, and we just talked to both camps and said, you know, we'll play referee, we'll put it all together afterwards and come back and play with it. That might be another one of those where that's just the, yes, we understand that, but we didn't think in moving from a statutory city to a charter city should be the moment at which you decided every issue in the city. So I can go through, I've scribbled upon this, and sometimes my scribbles look worse than they are because it's giving myself instruction that, hey, this paragraph this phrase should have been in this other sentence, and then I can wipe out two-thirds of a sentence to get short on that provision. And sometimes it was just the pronoun references, so it, all in all, it's in pretty good shape. The other thing that you would have to decide internally is any place that you've made a change in process as to do you want to do that, and even on some issues where, you know, do you have to bring that into the charter? And remember this, right now, a lot of the city function is handled by the city Board of Aldermen at their meeting. They are authorized to enter into contracts, not enter into contracts, whatever they see fit. They have a statutory package of authority. So as they exercise that, today's council can decide that they're going left. The next council after the following election can change direction and go right. That is true as long as it stays at their level. If you elevate it into the charter, it requires that change from left to right to be done by a vote of the people. And so you want to think about that. Is that, you know, are you making the city better or not by elevating it from the Board of Aldermen level up to only the people can tell you you can do that? So you have to think about that when you go through that. My thoughts are, if we go through the ones, the sections that you say you're done with, in the sense that you're, other than final editing, you're not intending to go back and visit, I can go through and do all of those, gender neutral, clean up any language, give you red lines. The ones that you're still wanting to discuss, I can be here or not be here, as you all choose when you're having the discussions of, do we want this in or out?
Well, I think we need you here.
Okay. But that's, you know, I basically committed to be with you till the end, so however it turns out.
Well, I'm very grateful for just you being that blunt to all of us with all these things. My personal feelings are that, now, on all the little things that just need a word tweaked here or there, is that something that you feel like we need to re-vote on as we make those changes, or individually, or can we just look at all the changes that you make and then make one decision to vote all those in or something like that?
What I have done in the past in those circumstances, that's why I said I would take it and put those into one red line without any substantive changes. These are just fixed language, fixed English, fixed numbers, that kind of stuff. And I bring that as a single thing with the idea and get it to you, you know, before the meeting, you know, hand it out with 400 changes and say, okay, let's vote on it now. Get it to you so you can look and make sure that you agree that I didn't change any meanings, and subject to the commission's wish, if they're happy, they can all say, fine with us. And remember this, every charter I've worked on, we took a couple of votes at the end. We went back through, okay, we went through it, we voted section, and sometimes, I swear, sentence by sentence, but mostly section by section, we approved it. Then when we thought we were done, we went back, starting at the beginning, and said, anybody got an issue still on this? You know, we've already voted, we've already said this is it, but we made sure that everybody had that last opportunity to say, wait a minute, what happened to this word? Or I thought that was in the last version I saw. So it caused everybody, it's a great editing thing, everybody read the whole thing again now in context, because that's the first time you really get to a clean document. And now you're just reading it the way other people are going to read it, but with great background. And so we went through it, and sometimes that took more than one vote, because a couple of times, just in the drafting, a sentence got dropped, a word got dropped, and that's when we caught it, got it corrected. So yeah, I think all of that can be brought, and it gives you a nice clean, it's almost like a fresh start. You guys have spent a lot of time getting this to where it is. This brings it back and you get one more fresh look, move on, and then you can really focus on the two, three, four, however many sections you still think you need to wrestle with. Just knowing that on January the 19th, unless you want to meet on Tuesday the 20th, but on January the 19th, you need to be able to say, we're done.
I don't even want to have to meet on that.
Well, and that's the other thing, when I was talking to the clerk, that's part of the reason her dates are what they are, because, and I appreciate this having dealt with election authorities before, you submit it and you think you got everything, and then they say, oh, this isn't where it's supposed to be. So she built in a couple of days so that if they didn't like what she gave them, she has time to fix it so it doesn't drop off the election, which I think is very wise on her part. Because that kind of stuff has been known to happen. And if you miss the deadline, you got a big lag before it comes back. And in your case, it can't come back because statutorily and constitutionally, it has to be on that ballot, or it can't. Now, it could be the starting point for the next charter commission, but who wants
lower
to go there? Okay, so what else do you want me to do?
Well, I think, you're going to go through and do all the minor things that you think you need to do to each separate article, other than those that we'll probably discuss tonight. And I think Greg had some things that he wanted to bring in, at least to have discussion on. There's always some word choices. We kind of talked about this a little bit in our meeting last Wednesday when we signed the contract. But, you know, certain words have been sticking points, and you know of those. And it's going to be interesting to hear your suggestions, especially on the preamble and Article 1. We spent a lot of time on those two.
Yeah, if I may, the reason why these items I'm bringing now haven't been here before is because we were lacking an attorney to be able to bounce this off, because I was beginning to start hearing legal opinions from different people in the room, and I really didn't know who was right, so I thought we should have one simple person to go to. If there is
no guarantee that I'm always right. My wife reminds me of that on a fairly constant basis.
But at least it takes away that the argument as to who's giving the opinion. And we're paying you to do this. So
right.
That puts a lot of weight with it.
Anybody else's thoughts besides Greg's or mine?
So basically what Greg is bringing is stuff to be added in here?
Mm-hmm. Not necessarily.
Well, that kind of stuff.
Basically,
right.
I did not put it in yellow to put it, so we just reprint basically what we said last time.
Lisa and I struggled real hard on writing language and argued about how to do it, and now we'll give it to you to tear it apart.
Well,
it's still the commission as to whether or not, you know, we decide we want it in there.
Yes.
And I guess in us discussing it today, we're looking at to you also, you've already given us the point where, you know, you want to not have something in there that's going to keep this thing from passing, and you want to pick your battles where you want to pick your battles, and
no problem there, mine are all populist.
here's one other thing I will tell you, and this is, again, some past practices. Everybody did not do this. But if I understand what you're trying to do, what you're trying to say, I may not be able to put it all together tonight as we're trying to go through lots of things, but once I understand, hey, this is the direction, then I can bring you back one or more proposed sets of language that says, okay, this will do it, and then you can, now you're focused a little bit more. And I just saw one, if you don't mind me asking. On your mayor pro tem, did you intend the mayor pro tem to have the power when he's acting in place of the mayor to veto ordinances?
No.
Okay. Because I would state that's been a sticking point in some places. And I think if you just state it, then the issue never comes up. It's
I think you also could, so that they cannot waive penalties and so forth either, which is in the current ordinances they have. I don't know if it's in this charter.
Well, and that may, again, the veto is a big thing, and it belongs to the mayor, because it came up when a mayor went on vacation in more than one city, and the mayor pro tem thought that
they're not always friends.
Yes, that they would or would not sign based on whatever the mayor would do. They were going to do the opposite, and it's just easier if you say the veto power, wherever the mayor's wandered off to, he's got the veto power, and that doesn't change.
He's got a pen with it.
So, okay.
Steve, can we take a break?
Take what?
A break.
Oh, a break.
Yeah. Oh, excuse me, hold a minute then.
That's up to the commission.
That's all right, that's just a problem. I'll be right back.
So you just suggest adding one sentence?
Yeah, I would, when I read that, I thought it would be nice and clear just to say, while acting for the mayor, this does not include the powers of blah, blah, blah.
Is that something that we would write, or he would just go ahead and?
I will write it, but that will not be in my, see, that is a substantive change, that is not a, I fixed your words.
Right.
So that will be on a separate list. Anything that I do like that, I will point out to you that, hey, this wasn't there, and I think it should be, or this is there, and I think you should take it out.
So I'm on C3 list, those things that we're still struggling with, those like this, where you want to, you feel like the protection needs to be in there for us, and then just the other little nuances.
Right.
Okay, so I don't need to worry about taking notes on whether it's just for veto power.
Right, no, no, and that's, I think that way we'll get to language, and it'll make a lot easier to, because I'll give you all this stuff electronically, and you can cut and paste.
And we're still operating underneath the contract, so where you don't see us doing anything that's outside the bounds.
We haven't talked about anything I didn't anticipate having to do with the commission, so. And again, like I said, part of the thing, I took the risk in doing that was I put a cap on my fees, and, you know, just because we burned through the hours that I thought I could do it in, it's, some people think it's, well, some people think it's justified. I'm notorious for saying, it'll only take 15 minutes, and 2 hours later, we're still working on it. That's my problem.
Are there any other suggestions like that for me to take?
That one.
He's gonna make us a list.
Yeah, I will make a list of those things, and I think the way I will do it is I'll probably put those in a reference to the section, and what my suggestion is and what my language is, so that you see it all in a little nutshell.
Sort of like my housekeeping, I usually do.
Yeah, that's what I anticipate.
Okay. Well, then I think the important thing now then is for you to get an understanding of what we felt was important to be in the charter, and even the ideas that are coming up currently now. If we just want to go through article by article or something like that, of different things like, you know, the suggestion for something on eminent domain. I mean, some type of protected wording that, I mean, is it something that's even necessary to put in the charter? And if you think that it is, then is there wording that works well, that kind of thing?
Here's what I'll tell you on eminent domain, and understand I spent most of my career on the condemning authority side. I've done some work for the property owner side. It would be hard to craft language that didn't have unintended consequences. And here's the kicker. Most people do not get excited when you have to condemn an easement to put a utility pipe in the ground to provide service. I mean, that just, and somebody says, I want $500,000 for the last foot and it's worth 50 cents. The only way you get it is to condemn it, and then you probably pay 50 bucks, but you didn't pay an outrageous part. So there's some very needed practical pieces of eminent domain. The second thing is, city's not the only authority that has eminent domain, and so if you took it away from the city, now you're going to make the utility folks have to condemn their own stuff, and many of them have the ability to condemn their own stuff. But that's a different kettle of fish, and now the city's not even a party. So like I said, so when you get into those types of thorny issues and you want to start bringing it into a charter, then I think you have to think long and hard about, do I really need that fight in my charter? There's lots of issues, tons of paper, tons and tons of cases on what you can and cannot do in eminent domain. And so if you thought you needed a provision, my first question to you is, Who and what are you protecting at the city level? And if you don't know, then it's like, okay, it's a concept, but I don't have to talk about it at all in the charter. The charter powers and other powers give the city the ability to exercise eminent domain subject to a long list of restrictions.
Well, obviously it was a concern of some of our commissioners, so, you know, just in the fairness of the whole thing, we wanted to hear both their sides and then your side too, so you had something that...
I'm just going to say, I think, was it you or someone brought up the issue with Walmart or other companies, excuse me, wanting to condemn and the city center of Raytown properties for whatever ventures. And then there's the issue of where I live, the property's been there, the family since the 40s. We have the property boundary marker where it has not moved since 1948 or 49, and yet every year goes by, you know, the city's like, oh, well, we claim this much farther into your land, theoretically, and, you know, for any given things, like, keep getting eroded. Is there any, there needs to be a balance struck, I think, because there's that issue with eminent domain, and then there's, like, as somebody mentioned with the downtown Raytown, just a matter of condemning it to, for public use, but public use could mean any number of different things. It could mean a private corporation because it benefits the public somehow. It could mean water park because, yay, water park. or just, I mean, it could mean library, but the likelihood is a lot lower that, you know, in that domain for a library. So there are issues like that where I think it might be too expansive to not include, you know, possible infringements. Eminent domain might be too expansive of an issue not to include some protections for the citizens in some ways, I think, is my concern. And I'm also speaking to another commissioner about there was apparently good language drafted for Detroit after that old debacle. That, I don't know, maybe we could look into that.
Which fish debacle? Detroit has a whole collection of debacles, so.
Well, but I mean, was it an ordinance that they did, or was it a change in the charter?
I don't know.
To know,
that's why I was asking, because if it's good language, maybe we can look into that.
Well, I think one of the things that I know is we don't want our city to threaten people with the thing of eminent domain. I think it's one of the things. I mean, there should be a fairness in acquiring property for development and so forth. And so, in the case last year, I had several people tell me personally that they thought they were threatened with that.
Yeah. The main thing is we're looking for is ways to block any abuses. Someone coming through, a developer coming through and say, well, I'm here to do this. Of course, if you're not cooperative, then we can always bring in eminent domain and just take it from you. You know, and sad as it may sound, that's how that's happened. And I think that, I don't know, one way I thought that you might be able to do it would be to require supermajorities of the city council to approve, which would give an added layer of protection.
You could do that. That would be the simplest, if you wanted to raise the level of protection, you have a 10-member council, so you say it takes 3/4 or 8 votes to approve eminent domain. And you guys can smack me if I do this. So now I'll flip over to the other side and say, well, that ain't much protection, because if the money is big on the other side and I know in advance I want to do it. I spent a lot of time wrestling with big corporations on behalf of the Municipal League, and I pointed out to them in a talk I gave that you're fighting with AT&T. AT&T's profit for 1 year exceeds all the budgets of every local unit of government in the state of Missouri. So when you think you're going to go wrestle with them, you just understand that you're an ant and they're a giant, but, you know, go right ahead and have a wrestling match. So the good news about just using supermajorities on eminent domain, it raises the issue you can put some slowdown provisions in it that says that you have to go, although understand, in the eminent domain process now in the state of Missouri, it's already slowed down because of the hoops you have to jump through. But you could add majority, you could add some timeframes,
Is this something that you feel might be a stickler to?
Well, what you have to think on a community level is most cities don't find it easy to exercise eminent domain now. It's not quite like it was in the Wild West days. So that part, there's already been a pendulum swing. The other issue I heard from Lisa has to do with the use for economic development, and that's one that I don't think is fully resolved, because the problem with economic development is as big as the ocean, maybe bigger. And so I say I'm doing it for economic development, and at the end of the day, 20 years later, you go, and where's the economic development? And all it looks like is Corporation A made more money. You could consider, and it might be possible, to draft something that curtails that use, or even requires unanimous approval of the council, which is practically on something that's a hot issue. In other words, 85% of all ordinances, all cities, are passed unanimously because they're no-brainers, they're routine business. It's just
the same thing with the charter.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's really true, because mostly you just got to take care of the business. So if you had a hot Walmart in the downtown issue, and you only have to get, and then you just decide, do I have to get 3 votes? Do I just have to get 1 vote? Do I have to get 2 votes? You know, what's it take to put the kibosh on this? So you could do some things there on economic development. And what that does is, and I think what you've got to think about, you want to be cautious about messing with utilities. Go back to the core of where eminent domain was. It was for the streets, it was for the sewers, it's for the water lines. You don't really want to be messing in that area, in my opinion, because those are significant things that it's normal. And you don't need to put more barriers than already exist. When you get to economic development, it gets different, because now it's somebody's vision, whether it's the city's vision, a developer's vision. Sometimes it's the property owner's vision to how I can make more money. But, you know, somebody has a vision, but I can only do it if I get your house. And I don't want my house to go. So let me look at that one and maybe bring you 2 or 3 choices that you can think about putting in. And then that may also change where they go in the charter.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have the full charter here, commission,
right,
as it is, and we have 8 out of the 13. I'd hate to even respond to a true discussion of whether or not we could put some of these things in there. That's why your advice is so critical to us at this point in time. But, I mean, I think the majority of us on the commission don't want to put anything in this charter that's going to keep it from passing. That's the thing.
Well, and I think you might be able to do this, and the other piece you may have to think about, and you will all have much better contacts with city folks, if you look at something, you say, oh, I think that makes sense. I think that gives citizens of Raytown a little better protection against the crazy developers just getting their 6 buddies on the council, and voila, we have a project. You might find out that most of the players in the city think that would be okay, because then you've insulated your elected officials a little bit more from the pressure. It's, you know, they got a reason, you know, hey, we'd have to get all of these, and that ward's never going to approve this. They're not going to give up their park to have a whatever it is. So let me give you some options there, and you can decide.
I mean, we're fairly unique in our downtown as it is, because we have a lot of vacant ground. So it could end up being just 1 or 2 properties that might be a stickler for somebody to come in for a development. It's not like they would have to garnish, you know, like 20 different properties in order to have a development.
Well, and that's part of what you have to weigh. And I'll give you another example. We had a a Everybody Wanted It project in a downtown, and there was one property owned by somebody who lived in Colorado and thought that the city, they must have thought it was downtown New York City, I have no idea why, but their values had all these extra zeros on it, and it was strictly to help the downtown redevelop. So if you take that away, that project would never have happened, because just having the power. Now the good news is sometimes the power doesn't have to be exercised, and people said, oh, okay, you're really serious, and you can find some other way to get it done. I'll also tell you, I did, the feds have some programs where you buy out property, and they specifically prohibit the use of eminent domain. So you can do some things, but let me give you some language, and you can decide if you want to put it in or...
There's another factor, excuse me, that Raytown, I don't know if they say we're unique in it, but as far as charter cities now, approving charters, we are pretty much insulated by Kansas City. We don't have room to expand.
Right.
To condemn outwards or anything of that sort. So I don't know. It's not like we think about putting a superhighway through tomorrow or something.
No, but, and this has happened, there have been instances where City A condemned inside City B for a public works type facility.
Awesome.
So you also need to, you know, they're not the usual circumstances, but in an urban area, often what you need, there's a physical requirement of what you're wanting to build, and it's not in your town, and it's, you know, just over the horizon and another town, and there's actually authority to do that for a municipal purpose. And so, again, you have to be cognizant of the fact that you're not always going to be able to do everything you want to do in your very defined boundary.
So you've heard our concerns there.
Yes.
Anybody else got something they want to speak on? Under 1.2B, there was some additional language, and some of this stuff we haven't even gone over, so... about treaties or agreements with other governments and stuff like that.
She's not here.
Yeah, no, Susan's not here to try to defend it, but I mean, I feel like you had Alan's thoughts, and I think they're, I mean, if I'm hearing you right, Alan, I mean, this is another one of those similar thoughts as do you really want to address it here or not?
So, just so I'm clear,
well,
treaty language, well, I know, but treaty language was at the end. The first sentence has been somewhat blessed.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not really sure how to phrase the treaty language. I've never given anything. She just suggested.
Well, that's just it. She has not had a chance to sell it, to make her pitch it, so let's not tear it apart until we hear. Well,
I don't think it's really a friendly discussion.
If she wants to bring it, let her bring it, and then let it stand on its own weight, and at that time it would be appropriate for him to speak to it. I mean, I've got my ideas. I'm willing to go toe-to-toe tonight on that if you want to.
All right, yeah, and so since you are here, Greg,
I'm dumb enough to speak up.
Then why don't you discuss the items that you had on your list?
I bring them. Okay, I have brought copies, because I know that there's been a number of different versions out there, and I wanted everybody to have. So I brought them in a nice orange color so they could recognize them.
And scrap paper?
There is no scrap paper.
Not in this day and age, you said, Greg.
No, sir.
That would be, I think I made one other change since then, but it was minor.
That's enough.
She did. Okay. Okay. Okay, Steve?
Yeah.
All right. Well, we touched on this two meetings back, and once again, I'm mostly concerned with items A, B, C, and D, and this goes to what you were speaking of about the negatives. Neither the city nor any city-affiliated agency may, and if the language is errors in it, I appreciate your suggestions for it. What I did, I my thought process on this was to see what is being done in other cities that is not working and try to make sure that they don't be tried here. The first one
determine to regulate the practice, regulate the price of privately held and transacted goods or services. And I used the situation in Kansas City, Missouri, with the little battle that's going on between Uber and Lyft and the taxi cab services, with taxi cab services being highly regulated in Kansas City. And in fact, if you go out there and you try to haul somebody around and have they pay you for it, you're breaking the law in Kansas City. So that's something that I think is a situation where it's an example of overregulation by a local government to what has turned out to be really the advantage of some taxi cab companies over others.
Does this include nonprofits that do this?
I did not go there to determine nonprofits or for-profits on it. My thought was that there are some areas where it's best just to let the marketplace provide be the guideline for you. And that's one of them where the city should not be setting the price for privately held transacted goods and services in a broad sense. And that's
so as far as what they're charging, is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, but I mean, that's kind of a special entity, isn't it? I mean, I would never let the city regulate what my fees were or something like that on my businesses.
Not all cities do what Kansas City does. Yeah, in taxi cab services.
But this Uber, this is called worldwide, because mm-hmm. the mm-hmm. New England or the London cabbies are having an issue with that too. But Uber is a software program designed for cab drivers on the private side on small companies, if I'm not mistaken. Where they actually, you can call up and have a cab scheduled and it comes in, picks you up.
It's done by private individuals.
Yeah.
And it comes down, I think, maybe to licensing and so forth like that. I don't want to go into that area about licensing, but it's something that is not being done, I don't believe, in other areas of the metropolitan area. You were an independent, so did you have any ordinances that regulated taxi cab services?
Well, not just taxi cabs, and I would guess, and I haven't looked at every ordinance in Raytown, but another common one is tow trucks.
They're licensed.
No, they're also regulated into what they can charge, because the police departments call them to come pull the wreck away, and so now you've got
That's a contract with the city, though.
Well, it's a contract with the city, in maybe or maybe not, because a lot of them it's just a rollover. So whoever's name's at the top is who gets the next call, and you can sign up to be on the list. We're not. And so now I put whoever's card is, you get company A, and the next one's going to get company B, and the next one's going to get company C. And so many of the cities have said, for this service, here's the cap. You can charge any number you want below the cap, but you're not going to charge people twice what it's worth to have their car towed, because we declare it has to be towed.
And that's because of the contract that they have with the city.
Sometimes it's a contract, sometimes it's because they're regulating tow trucks.
I know when I was on the city council here in Raytown, we voted on who got that contract. So that's how it was regulated, was through the contract.
That doesn't help people who get charged by people who pull up at the... All you were voting on was who's going to tow the police department's car.
That's what he was speaking of.
But this is also an issue of public property, Greg. Maybe we could rephrase this so when it comes to privately held or price of privately held and tax transacted services in private on private property. That way it would do away with that whole issue of towing off.
I'm open to anything that will make it work.
Sorry?
I said I'm open to anything that will make it work.
I think I like the idea. So I mean, for issues like this where it might get sticky, I think would that help maybe?
I appreciate the points you're bringing up, and Ted, also your comments.
So you're not saying that the city's going to regulate this as far as telling me what my nonprofit can do as far as transportation and cost?
No, certainly not my intent at all.
Okay.
In fact, you could exclude it in the language if you wanted to.
Well, because we're the only nonprofit in Kansas City, Missouri that can do this. Mm-hmm. And pick up and drop off in Kansas City. We had to get the Jitney Law changed. So that's why I didn't understand where you were going with this.
Shepherd Center?
No, it's IT and Greater Kansas City.
Shepherd Center, Trips also.
Well, Shepherd Center doesn't do it because Shepherd Center can't pick up and drop off. It cost me $115 to certify a volunteer to pick up and drop off in Kansas City, Missouri.
Mm-hmm. In Raytown?
We're only in the Summit Independence right now. So, but I just want to make sure of what this means. Because it's, because we will be in Raytown eventually. And so.
Well, the intent is to regulate and to slow down that type of operation where it keeps, where, by the city of over-regulation. That's the intent.
Like, for instance, if I sold shampoo and somebody else sold conditioner or something, I use that example, I think, once, and the city has a thing against people who sell conditioner because they hate conditioner or whatever, the people on the board. And so they decided that the conditioner would have to be sold for $100 a bottle just to be able to put them out of business versus people who sell shampoo. And they like shampoo, so they only, you know, put a price cap on that, you know, very low or something to that effect. It's just to keep it from determining the marketplace in the city, it would be how I look at this. That way it's not, the city isn't determining how businesses, it would make it difficult to run perfectly good businesses out of town, I think. Or, you know, alter the economic impact, but it would just have an economic impact, I would think. But that's just how I'm looking.
So when the old person who's in need of a doctor right now, today, this second, calls the first cab they can to pick him up from Bowen and take him to St. Luke's or whatever, and that cabbie charges him $65 for that ride, we don't want to have something to say about that? Because I'll tell you that there's people out there on 50 Highway charging people $900 to hook a car to the back of a tow truck. Mm-hmm. And we're on shaky ground to stop them and say, no, you're not doing that to people here. Because we don't have any regulation. But at some point, those two services in particular, transportation, towing services, the reason that things like that happen are because they can prey upon people who have little other opportunity or little choice. They can't drive, they don't have access to a bus that runs to one spot or another, they have to have a cab or they have to have their car towed from a traffic accident. And they're getting these price gouging things shoved at them and they have no choice. They're standing out there by the road. And they just have no choice. I understand what you're trying to do, but I think there's a time and a place for some regulation just to protect people, mm-hmm. which is what government's supposed to do, is protect people, not get in their business. I don't think they should be setting fees or interfering with commerce in any way, shape, or form, but when that kind of commerce kicks in, somebody needs to stand up.
I agree with you, that was not my intent. The situation was actually at the end where you were closing.
And I understand what Kansas City's doing and that they're getting carried away.
Well, we talk about the $10,000 lawsuits.
But isn't this again something that should be done by ordinance?
Yeah. I don't know.
I agree with that. But if you're going to do it by ordinance, though, you don't mention it in the charter.
Well, that's just it. Why hasn't it been done by ordinance?
Well, because it hasn't become at the forefront.
We haven't elected the right people, I guess.
Or both.
The regulations are actually what caused the problem to begin with, because if you didn't have the licensing and regulations that made it economically feasible to get a little, you know, mafia going in the tow trucking, you know, whatever you want to call it, to have kind of a just a hold on who can do it.
She's running a much higher.
Thank you.
You're suggesting that the city's permit has kept.
No, I just mean in general, it kind of gets to a mindset of, well, only these certain people can do this thing, and therefore they're going to price gouge.
Anybody can put a hook on the back of their truck and charge $900 and go on down the road.
But I'm just saying with an open marketplace, without kind of a segregated marketplace going on because of regulation, I would think it would open up the door for more people to even out playing.
If that were true, we wouldn't have that problem here, because we don't regulate it. So they're free to come in here and charge $900 to hook people up.
But that
comes from it doesn't matter what city you're in, though. It doesn't matter what city you're in. If somebody's standing on the road and they've got no other way, or it's a kid.
But if you've only got 20 tow trucks in the whole city.
Right, because of the regulation.
But that's what this really comes down to, is you have a limited amount of vehicles to do the towing. I bet you we could count probably 200 tow trucks in Kansas City, maybe 300. Supply and demand. The market sets the mark. They set the price. I'm with some of the conversations, the regulations. I mean, that's like true, like we have ice storm. You know, how many people go out and say, I'll charge you, $600 to clean your yard, and you got a tree smash on your park and everything else. So there's no regulating that.
No.
It's kind of.
I can see those signs.
Yeah, it's.
I think maybe the intent was different than the.
Well, the screen brought up here for certain.
Right, and it would be nice to find a balance there. I mean, unless you just don't think.
You want to move on to the next one?
Yeah. You brought up some good points today. B, create, sponsor, or oversee any kind of earnings tax or income tax on the people of Raytown. As I said before, the earnings tax in Kansas City, Missouri has been a disaster. It is chasing business out of the city. I know people that own property over there will tell me the stories of people coming to look at their property from out of town. They're interested in it. They want to buy it. They find out there's an earnings tax. They never call. They never answer the phone after that. Right now, I do not believe that in Missouri that you can have an earnings tax in this city. I think only St. Louis and Kansas City are allowed to statutorily. I could be wrong about that.
There's a split opinion among city attorneys as to whether or not other cities that are charter cities can.
Well, this
you use that as justification for adopting an earnings tax.
My point is that this is not the path to go, and I think it is a mistake, and I think that all we have to do is look to the giant around us that is failing because of it.
So let's agree with you, Greg.
Sir, you're saying to put something into the charter saying that we won't do that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Well, the other thing to think about that is if we were to do that, most of the people that live in Raytown don't work in Raytown.
The ones that live in Raytown have to pay it also.
I know, but then they're paying double for wherever they're living in Kansas City.
It's a dilemma. That's why there's another reason not to do it. Next one would be the use of dedicated sales tax revenue to fund any TIF, tax abatement, or program that would redirect such revenue from the purpose it was created. We have taxes in Raytown, the two most recognizable are the Raytown Transportation Sales Tax and the Public Safety Sales Tax. They were sold to the people, even in ballot language, that it would be used for transportation maintenance of streets, transportation services such as bus service and so forth. On the transportation side, on the public safety, it had to do with the ambulance service and the police department in particular. Whenever you develop, like in Raytown on 350 Highway, we have a very large Walmart. It's somewhat similar to what you have over there in Independence.
I don't go to Walmart. It's on my band list.
Anyway,
with the
Bass Pro, it was written that rich for Walmart that they capture every sales tax that they create within their store, and they are such a large economic footprint that they capture over 20%, I estimate around 25% of the sales tax revenue within the city. They're that much of a money machine. They're taking that much away from what is supposed to be used to maintain our streets, hire more policemen,
And it's not just the city of Raytown it's happening to. It also happens to the sales tax that's being used by the fire district. So it's all going for purposes other than what it was told, what the people were told it was going to. Can't do anything going back. Those agreements have been written and signed. We're stuck with that TIF for, I think it was a 23-year life. However, looking forward, any schemes to come forward along those lines, any plans to come up forward along those lines, would be restricted from using those dedicated taxes for that purposes. And you can write that into the agreements that we have with the taxing entities that we create. For instance, on 350 Highway, at Walmart, it was the 350 Live district, which is that whole district. It's not just Walmart. There's also a couple of other stores in there that also are collecting on that sales tax, which goes to pay the debt for that district. One of them being IHOP restaurant, Westlake Hardware. I don't know if the bank really is affected by it too much because they really don't
have
retail.
They're not selling anything. So.
Yeah, just trading dollars. So that's the purpose there, is to pretty much put a safety net around our guaranteed and dedicated sales taxes. And that, I think, is something that I, quite honestly, I don't trust any city council not to consider going there. That's why I want to put it in the charter, because I believe if you put it in the charter, there's only one group of people that can turn it around, and that would be the voters. So they would have to make the decision. Item D is another item that is similar to item C, and it has to do with contribution of public funds derived from city taxes as a donation, payment, or gift to intergovernmental research or promotion of political issues without consent of the people through direct vote of a ballot issue. As an example, I've used in 2012, the Board of Aldermen donated $10,085 to the Jackson County Regional Transit Plan Educational Program. The purpose of the donation was to educate the public of the need for light rail in Jackson County, Missouri. Whether you agree with the issue or not, that's not why we pay our taxes. It is for the board to determine what things we should promote to create other taxes coming down the line, and that's exactly what that was for. Now, so far that hasn't happened. I understand that a group, I don't know if it's the same group, but a similar group is coming back now again saying, well, now we need more money. And there are alternatives to what they're suggesting, and it does not address that, is what I'm saying, in the pitch that's being made. So.
But that would have direct effect on the city of Raytown.
Depends on what you're talking about.
Light rail.
It would.
If it came down the rail lines.
It would.
So you're saying that $10,000 was not...
It's not why I paid my tax dollars. I don't especially agree that fixed rail is the best way to do mass transit.
That's your personal opinion. I would disagree.
Okay. And obviously the majority of the Board of Aldermen, but do the majority of the people of Raytown agree that it was the best way to go?
No.
Because that was an endorsement of that concept.
Yes, it was.
And it was not done without their approval.
The whole thing is it was just a
but if
presentation
we weren't at the table,
they could do for
we
free,
know.
But yet...
Well, you can go to the table. You can support
it.
You can stand up there and say... You can stand up there and say, I'm for this and I support it. I have no problem with that. If the elected body wants to say, we think this is a great idea and we're going to go out and work for it, I think that's great. They should. However, when they take public funds and say, we're going to go out there and we're going to educate it with your own money...
It's campaigning.
That's campaigning.
Yeah.
You can try to wash it any way you want, but that's exactly what it is.
Is there another way this could be looked at?
Is it campaigning or just trying to educate?
Or are they trying to educate? Are they trying to educate that electric buses are just as a viable situation where you don't have to tear up and buy a railway right away?
Well,
is this the education package right here?
What they were doing was, it really wasn't as much a donation as a payment for services for the research to do that study. Every municipality.
Have we got a copy of the study?
Yes. We should have a copy of the study.
I'd like to ask for a copy of that study.
You should be able to get anything that, all the research that was done in regards to that.
I don't even know where to get a hold of this group. I had trouble digging it out of the newspaper.
Oh, John Benson should be able to give you a lot of information.
I'll ask him for the copy of the study.
But I mean, Charlotte, wouldn't you agree that, I mean, that's what the city was paying for? I mean, they were just one of one.
Mr. Chairman, I would have to read the study to make a pass judgment on whether or not it really was a study.
All right, Ted, go ahead.
We're arguing about a specific instance here. Greg is trying to, and I understand Greg's unhappy about that instance, but he's trying to present something to go on the charter here.
Right. There are other instances besides just that one.
Ten other instances where you think would be not worth the labor for the city or something?
No, I think we need to stop arguing that instance.
Oh.
Focus on
well,
this.
That's what I mean is that I'm just trying to think of counter arguments, other arguments.
But wouldn't this, if you had some type of issue that was time sensitive, then you'd have to go through, because you're going through direct vote of the ballot issue.
No, only to approve the use of the funds for that.
Right, that's what I'm saying, but if it was a time sensitive thing.
That the world would end tomorrow if we don't do it. I don't see as where it stops anybody from saying this is a good idea and we should do it. It just says you can do it, they can go out and raise funds if somebody wants to do it. Do any particular item like that. You know, I just know that when I pay my taxes, it's with the understanding to the city that these are going to be for my city services that I have. And perhaps I have a narrower view than everybody else does of what our city services are. But I don't consider education and well, once again, Ted, my apologies, but going, this is a perfect example. I'd have to see how I was going to be educated.
I don't understand what you're
okay.
saying.
Okay. Well, in other words, that's not why I pay taxes.
Well, I don't disagree okay. with that.
That's what I'm saying.
I just wonder whether it's wrong as a charter. I agree with you that...
I think it does.
I mean, I think you've got good reason to say that you don't trust city councils.
On this particular issue, yes.
But I think that's the vagaries that come from electing people to sit on those boards for us.
Well, I'd like to hear from the attorney what he thinks.
A couple of things when you get to drafting it. You have multiple issues. If you look at this, you're talking about unidentified funds from city taxes. Does that intentionally or unintentionally exclude fees? And again, those are two different sources of money. Then it also talks about research. There are a number of times two cities, particularly again in landlocked situations, get together to study something. You just prohibited that use. I assume that Raytown periodically plays with MARC. That's another intergovernmental agreement, and they're often doing research. And again, when you use the term political issues, that's some people think that's a narrow band, other people think it includes anything and everything. So I think what you have to do is you have to decide what's the harm that you want to prevent and draft it specifically to fix that problem, not again, have unintentional consequences that you just eliminated some more of the authority.
We need to define the issue. Is that what you're saying?
Well, you have to, when you're writing a charter, you first have to say, is this something that I need to prohibit at the charter level or make it very difficult for people to do? And then what is it that I really don't want to not give money to Jackson County,
well, I believe we give like $6,800 to MARC every year.
Right, which is yeah, and
your membership fee.
And, well, you have membership fees, but again, what you have to think about is if I think that, you know, what does MARC do with the money after they get it? They run around, they do research, and they do educational promotions. I mean, that's mostly what MARC does. So, did I intend to prohibit that? On the other hand, is if I want to have a local prohibition,
about money that's tied to a ballot issue that's coming, because I think that was kind of what this was, right?
That, this was only an example. I did think of Mark in my thought process of this, and I figured
it
probably would come up.
Which are you asking about? Are you asking about the special taxes?
Well, no, this
D?
When you look at what, are you trying to prohibit when they're using the educational campaign to actually promote an issue, which in spite of the prohibitions, I mean, that's what happens. Municipalities are banned from saying vote yes, vote no, but I can still put out a brochure that after you finish reading it, you can't imagine why anybody would vote no. And so if that's what I'm trying to do is when it gets down to there's now an actual campaign, you can write that, and you haven't had that collateral effect of all the other things that cities do with other governments jointly. On the other hand, if you write it in broad words, where I can't do anything with another government for research purposes on road corridors, on cable corridors, on gas pipelines, I've eliminated a whole lot of things that may be in the best interest of the city. So you have to figure out what harm it is you don't want to have. And if there is such a harm, then we draft narrowly. And again, same thing we talked about before is you have some intermediate steps from an absolute ban. Okay, an absolute ban just says the only way you can fix this is you have to amend the charter. You have the next tier, which is I'm going to elevate in this area the number of votes you got to get before you can go play with other people. So you could do something on an intermediate. But either way, you still got to identify the harm you want to prevent and then focus on this is the harm. And then
which is primarily lose an hour tax dollars to some other place that's not providing us a benefit. Isn't that right, Greg? Isn't that what you're looking for?
I was just thinking of different ways to protect the ability to work with other groups, at the same time not fall prey to some groups who would come in and sit. Somewhat similar to what we're talking about with tow trucks.
Mm-hmm.
It happens. I've seen city councils get caught up in the moment and make really, really poor decisions. And sometimes it's all on pie in the sky stuff. And this is what I want to protect against. Mid-American Regional Council, it has its purposes. And I mean, and many of the things that it does are good for communities. There is no political way to recycle hazardous waste, for instance, and so forth, if you follow me. And those are good things. However, when it comes to selling an issue that is pretty much not so much selling the issue as it is leading people to that issue and saying this is the alternative that we need, to me that's the same as saying yes.
Well, and again,
I think this is important, and yes, it needs to be tightened down quite a bit. I can see that. I'll try. If you want to help me.
Well, I guess my vote is for you to take another step so that I'm sure I understand what you're trying
okay.
to get to before
I can do that.
We can.
I'll try. Okay, contract employee agreements. This is not really a way to tell the city council how to act on anything, except that I believe that they should be reviewed annually, and I believe during that annual review that either party should be able to come into it and make suggestions as to changes in the contract employment agreement, and that's basically it. I want to open the door.
We have language to include an annual review, but not to alter the contract, which I don't know if that's even legal to do. Once a person
city council already has.
Well, but if I got a 3-year contract with the city, I got a 3-year contract.
I know, but the city council at the end of that 3-year contract has already made alterations to it. When you take, for instance,
but not yearly at the annual review.
Why not?
Well, because it's a 3-year contract.
That's
since
an annual contract.
Since you and I talked, that's the thing that has has been bugging me is if you and I enter into an agreement where I'm going to do a project over 3 years or provide a service over 3 years, but the agreed upon terms for that are subject to change, then where's the contract? There's no contract.
Well,
that's not a contract.
We have a contract that's subject to change in the city of Raytown already. This specific example would be our city administrator. He came here, went to work for the city with a clear understanding of the terms of the agreement to work here, that he would take residence here. He asked for a 3-year extension. He was given one. The contract was changed. Three years later.
How does an annual review help that, I guess, is what I'm lost on.
I think 3 years is too lengthy.
Well, but I mean, you're going to have a hard time getting anybody to sign less than a couple
of doing baseball.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know that I'm worried about putting something like that in the charter, though. That completely eliminates the possibility of having a contract over the length of a year.
It goes back to the city council. It's not the charter that's making the decision on. City council then would be up to them to make any changes if they even wanted to.
But you're eliminating the opportunity to have more than a 1-year contract if you put this in the charter.
Yes.
So, Greg, if somebody wanted to be city administrator and they had to move their entire family to Raytown to do that, and do you think they're going to enter into that for a 1 year? Maybe they'll can stay, maybe they won't. I don't see it happening. It's way too much.
It would have to be a 3.
It's just a lot of people.
I can see if you want to put a cap on how many years you want to put an employee under contract, but annual is awfully short.
Is there a review? Is a review that has no real consequence, or just other than the review itself?
Well, yeah, the review itself. I mean, even Mahesh's contract, that review, if he's not living up to his side of it, you know, he can be told he's not performing to the standard of the contract, and he has to make improvements. I mean, that's where I read his contract. So.
Okay.
Or, I mean, the other thing is the city could let him go at that point if he's not performing according to.
So do you want to write it backwards then? I think maybe is what Ted is suggesting.
The thing that I'm worried about is the very thing that the attorney touched on earlier is however you construct this, if you build in a means by which either the employee or the city are guaranteeing litigation.
I don't know if that guarantees litigation. Was
there
litigation?
Well, the contract.
Litigation when the contract was changed the first time?
No, but the contract you and I talk about, if I, the employee, have the opportunity to say that, you know, if you tell me you think I ought to go, and we've defined cause too narrowly, then whenever it's suggested that I should go, by whomever suggests I should go, I have cause for action. And it doesn't really matter who wins, because I'm going to get something out of it, and you're going to pay something.
It's okay. What I'm suggesting is that could be changed.
I don't know how you can change what the court is going to do.
Well, it's by agreement between the two parties.
That didn't stop you from going to court, is my problem. And what he's saying is absolutely true. The city does this all the time. The minute somebody walks into court, the cash register rang. It just rang. And then the next thing that happens is they go to the city council and they'll. We're going to have to go to court to protect ourselves here, and so we have to hire counsel, which you do, and the cash register just rang again. Mm-hmm. Necessarily, and I understand that, but when you open the door to go to court to argue.
Well, I'm not suggesting that. I'm suggesting that it be able to open to negotiation.
I think
every 3 years. In fact, it may be already.
Now you're talking about putting a 3-year cap.
Well, I definitely heard that everybody in the room say 1 year's too short. But I don't think that when
think
something's written down,
is.
I mean, look, if we took that attitude, we'd still have slavery in these states. Yep.
Well, my concern is when you're talking about an employee review, though.
Mm-hmm.
And if that employee review results in a penalty to that employee's pocket,
it does not.
If it results in a penalty to that employee pocket, you'll go to court. That's an unfortunate fact.
I'm not seeing how, if you have an employee review and you discuss the contract, that one, it would always be contrary to what the employee wants, and two, there would always be lawsuits on the...
Okay, but maybe I'm confusing reviews here. I'm talking about a performance review. Maybe you're just talking about reviewing in terms of...
Yeah, just reviewing in terms of the contract.
Yeah, but who's going to, I mean, even if I was to look at a contract like that, why would I sign a contract as a contract employee, knowing that the city might be able to change it, and we might have a disagreement as to whether or not I was performing or not?
Is it just...
Well, you're assuming that that's the reason, that's the only place it would be changed.
Is it just an issue of both parties being able to agree on a change if they wanted to?
Yes.
It's not like somebody's one side's forcing the other.
Well, actually, I don't see how one side could force the other.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. Is it so just a thing that if they wanted, either side wanted to tweak something and the other side agreed to it, they could go ahead and do that? I mean, why can't they do that as a matter of course at any time?
There's nothing set up to be able to do that.
I mean, they can't do that as a matter of course now?
I don't know how.
But I think don't we already have language in there for, like, the city administrator that says, or any other... item of agenda that the board or the mayor might have. I think there is.
I don't understand. I don't understand what you're pointing out.
Well, I mean, under Article 5.5, City Administrator, Item 15, perform such other duties as are specified in this charter and may be required by the Board of Aldermen. I mean,
if you want to just discuss the duties.
But if the city wants to change something, I mean, this right here gives them the possibility.
As far as their duties are concerned.
Aren't these contracts, when the contract is made out, is it made out, I can't remember, it's been a while, that the contract for this employee is set out by ordinance in how it's written?
We have a copy of the contract.
What?
Yeah, it has to be signed by the copy of the contract.
Yes. The lawyer looks at it.
The board voted on it.
Well, with the vote on a contract, you don't have to do that by ordinance, I think, is your question, right?
Our resolution.
I mean, if there's an ordinance saying he has to...
Well, I just know it was voted on. I don't know whether it was an ordinance or resolution. I just know that it was voted on publicly.
Well, we just did on board.
Contract,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the only two.
Yeah, you only have two. Yeah.
So we just did that.
And this is not exclusive to the city administrator. This would be for all contracts.
Is the city clerk?
Well, I personally don't see a need to include something like this in the charter. I mean, that's my personal opinion.
Mr. Lawyer?
Okay.
Well, this goes back to is this a day-to-day operation, or is this something that you want to elevate to either a requirement or a prohibition? If all it achieves is that the two parties can agree, that's always the case. If there's only two parties to a contract, anytime the two want to get together and agree on an amendment, they can do it. It's not triggered by an annual review or anything else. If I'm a party and you're a party and we get together and say, hey, let's change this clause to something else, we can do it. So from that standpoint, you're not achieving anything. And I guess that again, what is it that is trying to be accomplished? I want to have all contract employees have an annual review. That sounds like the administrative policies of the city. I mean, all employees are supposed to have an annual review. So why am I picking on contract employees to the point I'm going to put them in the charter? Why are they more critical? Because frankly, they're easier to get rid of than the non-contract employees. So again, what am I trying to accomplish, and why does it need to be at a charter level, would be my questions.
I think that the important thing that you're trying to accomplish is that this gives an opportunity to where you have a forum set in place where both the city and the contract employee may negotiate to make changes to the charter agreement.
But they can, you've chartered, you didn't give them anything they didn't already have.
This is something I can't speak to a discussion I'm not going to be part of, or that has not happened yet.
I'm not sure I can speak about that one.
Okay. What it means is this it sets in stone that you will have this avenue to take if you want to. And I really don't know why all the consternation about it. To be honest with you, city ordinance.
They do have a performance rating.
Once again, it gives both the city and the contract employee may negotiate, make changes in the contract agreement. That's not part of the review.
But that can be done by amendment anyway. I got what I'm saying.
Well, so you say, but I just, it's rare.
Well, no, because Lash's contract was
in a three-year at the end of the term.
Yeah.
And that amendment was within the Board of Aldermen?
No, one was in 2012, which wasn't one of its contract years.
When was the first one?
Well, 2009 was one.
And 3 years later, 2012.
No, excuse me. 2010 was one. Mm-hmm. Then lasted, or 2011. Trying to think of what year it was. He's been going on a 3-year contract. His contract was up.
And actually, beginning of Steve, I'll be honest with you, this is not written with only him in mind.
Right,
when I wrote it, I didn't even know how many contract employees we had.
Right.
I was surprised we only had two, because I thought we had four, but I know that we've had some change. We've had some turnover recently where I think some of them are probably gone now. I really think we're kind of going in circles here.
Yes.
We are.
And I don't think you or I are going to back down.
Let's go on to the next.
So if we can go on to the next.
Well, before you do, why didn't you just include contract employees in 5.2?
Didn't have an attorney.
Well, no, but I mean,
look, I've been trying to get you on board 2 or 3 months now, okay? Now I won't go there, but I mean.
I mean, seriously, why, again, it's back down to putting a red flag on something if you just said for all employees, because it says, if you think about it, if you just look above, you've already done this. Board of Aldermen shall adopt by ordinance within 12 months of adoption a personnel code providing comprehensive personnel system for officers and employees. Sounds to me like you've already done it. And you gave them 12 months to do that instead of 3 months.
So anything that specifically says that there may be an open to negotiation review at that time would belong in 5.2, is that what you're talking about?
I wouldn't put that in, because you're not so charter is designed to balance powers, rights, however you want to think about it, but if they already have it and it's not going to change it, then why would I put it in?
Well,
these
positions are different than the other positions within the city, and I think they deserve to be treated differently.
But again, back to, and the commission has to decide. It's not the commission's job to write the personnel code. You assigned it to the Board of Aldermen.
That's right. We're only saying that you will meet and review this. I mean, look,
right,
like I said, we're going
to
circle
to the bathroom.
Yeah.
I do have one more item, if you don't mind. Maybe.
Okay. You have one more item, and then.
Well, it's just a real
break
for the
evening, to be quite honest with you.
Okay, elected right. Officials' right to bring legislation. Actually, I pulled this from the City of Independence charter, and it guarantees the right of any member of the Board of Aldermen, to bring legislation before the Board for consideration in public session. I don't know what the situation is now. I do know at one time we required 3 co-sponsors in Raytown to bring legislation.
Well, wouldn't that be up to the Board of Aldermen to sell his product or what he wants to do with several other aldermen before trying to bring it in?
If they want it to pass, I'm certain they will. However, it's just something that I know that is done in other cities, and I think it's a good idea, because otherwise we try to stay away from what we call the tyranny of the majority, where if somebody doesn't want to hear something, but it's an issue.
Yeah, but if you can't convince three already, then it's not going to go again, right?
Don't especially know that. I can give you very good examples of minority positions that have been held for a very long time, not just in local government, but in state and national governments.
We're talking great now.
I know that, and that's why I use the word local. That's why I said local government.
But in the current process, you can, if you have an issue, you can bring it and put it on
can
board
you
discussion.
Put it on, can you put it on the agenda as a board, as an item to be voted on?
You can bring it as a board discussion.
I didn't ask that. I know you can bring it as a board discussion. Can you bring it to put it up? Can you put it on the agenda, or must you?
You need to go through process.
And what is the process?
You need to bring it as board discussion, and as discussion in the facts that you bring forward to the Board of Aldermen. If the majority say that you want to go forward with that, then the staff will work on it to bring it forth as an ordinance or resolution.
That's the tyranny of the majority.
When I first saw the
But you got to have a process.
That's not a good process.
It just looked opaque to me, the process to go about it, because it just looked, for all intents and purposes, like the mayor decided everything.
It's a way, it's a way to keep a minority voice down.
There's no clear way to...
Yeah, but if you bring it as a board discussion, and you bring my way to do that, is I bring my, you know, sheet of facts. Here's what I'm bringing forward. Here's my facts. Here's my research.
At a meeting or a different meeting? I don't know.
No, that's at the end of the Board of Aldermen meeting.
I've seen.
And you bring forward that, and you lay out all your things. And if it's not the majority of the board, it's not going to go forward. Then you need to educate the rest of the members of the board better on what you're talking about.
Well, should we have a policy in place on how to go about that? Because I just don't remember seeing that.
We just had one on the smoke shops.
I'm just saying it's not clear to me personally. Is there, Mr. Lawyer, is this normally something that is done in either ordinances or in charters where it's stated how...
that you must
articles
get permission
to be discussed
before you
or brought up
something
to the rest
before
of
the
board? Like the process for that?
Most of that process is by adoption of procedural rules by the governing body.
Exactly, which they will not do.
And so the concept that exists at every level of government is that those rules change from time to time. And so they are controlled and adopted by the body. In this case, the Board of Aldermen says, okay, the procedure we want to have so that staff's not doing 27 things and are not subject to direction by a single elected official is, here's the process. You bring an idea to here. If there's sufficient support, whatever that is, it moves to here. And that becomes, that's the essential introduction. So any elected official can bring anything they want to the front end of the process. If I understand what's...
I mean, that's why they're elected, isn't it? They're supposed to represent the citizens.
Well, but here's the difference, and this is part of what happens, and it's not necessarily tyranny of the majority. Sometimes it's tyranny of the city manager. Sometimes it's tyranny of the mayor. Somebody controls the agenda. You cannot have anything on my agenda unless I say you can. So you keep saying I want to introduce this ordinance, I keep not putting it on the agenda, so it's not on the agenda. Technically, the agenda belongs to the body, and the body can say, I move, you know, we don't care that it's not on here, I move that we add item X to the agenda. And so, again, it's still going to be subject to the body as to how they want to do that. So I have to think about... If it's the tyranny of the majority and they say this is the process we want to use and you can't make it through the process because you can't ever get over that hump, I'm not sure what it accomplishes, but I don't know that it's one of those, I don't know that it harms, you know, some things have negative and positives and some things are just neutral, they don't really tilt, so.
Well, and I agree with the aspect of adopting the rules by the Board of Aldermen, the Board of Aldermen, for those procedural aspects on how to bring something forward. I have brought the procedural aspects to the board three times, and it never went anywhere, because they won't vote on the procedures to have on the board. So, you know, that's just kind of how it goes, and that's why we fly with that one.
Those came about 2000.
Yeah, I wrote them.
Before that, the city operated without them all those years.
So to keep from gatekeeping from happening, and then in any sense, would you recommend there be any sort of statement about that in the charter? Or that they must decide on a procedure and put it into ordinance or something to that effect, even if it doesn't state it clearly?
Well, you have some procedure that you've already written. And you also have a provision, Board of Aldermen shall determine its own rules and order of business by ordinance. So they have to have rules that they adopt. So I guess the question is, how does this fit into
subject to this rule?
Again, it may be one that
I don't think on paper.
You didn't just say that.
Yes, I did.
you could add a sentence to your current 310B that just says the Board of Aldermen shall determine its own rules and order of business by ordinance. No rule shall restrict the right of any elected member to bring. Again, it says legislation. I'm not sure you want to use legislation, but to bring an issue before the board for consideration. Public session is, if it's a private, back to Sunshine Law, if it's there's public-private, I'm not sure. All the sessions of the board when it's doing business are open to the public, except for those that fit under the Sunshine Law, so I'm not sure that that adds anything.
Which section is that, please?
310B. And that's one of the other things, again, it has to get a little bit more cleaned up, but at some point, it's to look to make sure that we put everything into the right article and the right section, so you don't have a rule over here and a rule over here, and everybody here knows that we have two rules, but if they're in two different sections, somebody just reads one of them down the road, and this is the other one.
I'm listening. Honestly, to what you're saying, and I will work on these and bring them back when we have a fuller commission to discuss and possibly vote on. Some may not come back at all.
I think we're going to end with that.
But we do have one other thing to accomplish: minutes. We never did approve on that. And we don't have a new treasurer's report yet because the grant hasn't been paid yet. I didn't get you the
hacker.
So has everybody had a chance to read the minutes?
We have the minutes for the last meeting and then the last two markings that we
have. But would those be approved by the market?
Yes, they are.
So we're basically needing the motion to approve last week's minutes, which were very short.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, we're going to take a vote. While she's doing it, thank you, Alan.
You're welcome.
It's been very helpful and informative. And, we knew we would get to this point.
Question for Amway. Charlotte Nelson?
Yes.
Mark Moore?
Yes.
Lisa Emerson? Yes. Ted Bowman?
Yes.
Janet Emerson? Yes. Sandra Hartwell?
Yes.
Greg Walters?
Yes.
Steve Gunther?
Yes. Okay, Sandy, do you have a question?
Yeah, I was asked to ask this question. She's not here tonight.
A proxy.
You have read everything that we have up to now, right?
Yes.
Is there anything in that? Well, I'll back up. We have a charter member who is going around telling people that if you're under contract, it won't change that contract. So her question was, is there anything in the charter that says it will change it?
Are you talking about
residency? Change an existing contract?
Yes.
Generally speaking, and I didn't focus on that, normally in your transition, and I think it's there, is a preservation of contracts in existence as long with the ordinances in existence. And so you basically, just because there's so many contracts, you put that in so that the contracts just continue, that you're not changing the authority or anything else, and they come back up in their normal cycle, whatever their normal cycle is.
I know I asked that question that night that it came up, and I think I was told that yes, it will, but this other person who is talking out there is telling people that it won't change their contract. So we do need to know that.
I will look again at that, but that's just one of the provisions you usually put in because you really don't have any choice unless you want to cause a raid on the city treasury.
Yeah, exactly. We don't do that.
Yeah, so, but I'll make sure it's there.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions for Alan before we adjourn?
When do you get together next?
The next Monday.
Okay.
The first.
We're at
Fire Station.
Please turn the heat up.
Okay.
I'm recording my answer.
Okay. I'm supposed to have surgery that day, but I'm not so sure. I won't be able to make it.
Do you have a calendar beyond the next meeting?
Every
Monday from now till you're done?
Which, yeah.
I have it on the website.
Okay.
We have to confirm it with Teresa for December.
Okay.
I think you've already done that.
I'll check my calendar throughout. I have a board I'm president of that we meet at 4, and I usually try to make sure they're done by 6, but it's further away than my house. So I may not be able to get here right at 6:30 on that day.
So if since this is the adjournment, thank you. Is everybody getting up?
Everybody's leaving.
I'm ready. Are we?